Good morning, and welcome to Littleton Church of Christ Live Online, where Phil and Sarah and Molly Sikora.
You know, this is the longest we've ever been away from the church building in 40 years, but we haven't been away from church.
You know, and it's due to the efforts of people like the production crew and Joe Vaughn and the staff. They've just done a wonderful job keeping us all connected. And I want to give a special shout out to Michael Renwick. I know he works many, many, many hours. It's much harder to put this on than a normal church service. So thank you, Michael. And thank you, Monty Dent. Have a great worship.
And you get to bring your dog to church.
We love you.
Good morning. As we close our celebrations of the 4th of July holiday weekend, many of us still have in mind the freedoms and the privileges that we enjoy living in this country. And while we still have a long way to go to ensure that those same freedoms and privileges are extended to everyone equally, one thing that we do know is that we have that privilege to worship freely. And so I encourage you to join us now as we sing together.
Oh, worship the King, all glorious above, and gratefully sing His wonderful love. Our shield and defender, the Ancient of Days, pavilioned in splendor and girded with praise. Thy bountiful care, what tongue can recite? It breathes in the air, it shines in the light. It streams from the hills, it descends to the plain, and sweetly distills in the dew and the rain. Frail children of dust and feeble as frail, in Thee do we trust, nor find Thee to fail. Thy mercies, how tender, how firm to the end, our Maker, Defender, Redeemer, and Friend.
Hello, Littleton Church, and welcome to our online service. My name is Amy Wiley. I'm so happy you're here. And if it's your first time joining us, we're just so glad you found us. We hope we are a blessing to you today, and we appreciate you worshiping with us in this way. I hope everyone is having a nice 4th of July weekend. Go ahead and give us a heart emoji or a smiley face in the chat right now so we know you're here and you're happy to be here. Okay, we also want you to share this service on your social media. Invite your Facebook friends to worship with us. That would be such a blessing to them, and we'd love to share the love of Jesus in that way. We also are going to have a time of communion a little bit later in the service, so it won't hurt my feelings if you hop up right now and get your supplies ready so you have those on hand when we get to that point. At Littleton Church, our mission is to love God and go love people. Our vision is reaching the next generation for Jesus while being transformed into His likeness. Next week, we are going to hear from Justin Thompson, who is our former missionary, who is in Lima, Peru. He and his family, his wife Allison, their kids Caitlin, Corbin, Chloe, and Carter, they planted a church in Lima, and they have recently returned to the United States, so we look forward to hearing from Justin, and the Thompson family will join us at our prayer and praise gathering. That gathering is an outdoor prayer and praise gathering, as I said. That's going to be on July 12th, Sunday evening at 7 p.m., weather permitting, in the West parking lot. And we have two options for you. You can bring your own chair and kind of set up shop that way, or if you're more comfortable staying in your car, you can do so and tune in on a radio station that way. But either way, we want to know you're coming. We need you to RSVP so that we can adequately prepare. So just go to littletonchurch.org, click on the prayer and praise link, and reserve your spot that way. Now I want to read to you from the Word of God. This is 4, verses 13 through 16. We know that we live in Him and He in us because He has given us His Spirit. And we have seen and testified that the Father has sent His Son to be the Savior of the world. If anyone acknowledges that Jesus is the Son of God, God lives in Him and He in God. And so we know and rely on the love God has for us. God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God, and God in Him. Will you pray with me, please? Dear Lord, thank you for living in us through your Holy Spirit. Thank you for your love. Thank you for teaching us about that love and help us to show it to others. Lord, we pray that you heal our land, that you heal our world right now in so many ways. Put your hand on us, God. It's in Jesus' name we pray, amen. And now stay tuned for a message from our children's minister, Kelsey Aldridge.
Hi, I'm Kelsey Aldridge. I'm the children's minister here at Littleton Church of Christ. I'm so excited to announce that we will have day camp this summer. Day camp will be July 27th through the 30th. We will be following CDC guidelines for day camps this summer. To review our safety precautions that we will be taking, go to our website, www.littletonchurch.org. Stay on the main page and scroll all the way down and click Elementary Day Camp. There you will be able to view all of the precautions we are taking, as well as register your child. This year's theme for day camp is Happy Camper Adventure Awaits. We will learn that Jesus teaches us and guides us on how to live, and we will learn that through learning a different parable each day. The cost is $75 per kid, and it is for our current kindergarten through fifth graders. Again, go to www.littletonchurch.org to register. I'm so excited about day camp this year, and I can't wait to see everyone.
We have come to worship him, to lift his name on high. He is worthy of our praise, so let us lift him to the sky. We have come to worship him, to lift his name on high. He is worthy of our praise, so let us lift him to the sky. He is my Savior. He is the King of Kings. He is the mighty God, and of his awesome deeds we sing. And our highest praise to him we bring. We have come to worship him, to lift his name on high. He is worthy of our praise, so let us lift him to the sky. He is my Father, he is the Prince of Peace. He is the risen Lord, and of his awesome deeds we sing. And our highest praise to him we bring. We have come to worship him, to lift his name on high. He is worthy of our praise, so let us lift him to the sky. We have come to worship him, to lift his name on high. He is worthy of our praise, so let us lift him to the sky. Let us lift him to the sky. Let us lift his name on high.
Good morning, Littleton Church of Christ. I hope you guys are having an awesome Sunday so far. Just real quick, if you don't already know who I am, my name is Josh Duncan. I'm the youth ministry intern here this summer. I've been here for about 3 weeks so far, and I'm really enjoying getting to build relationships with the teens and with Tyler and the staff here at the church. So I just want to say thank you to everybody for having me here this summer. So I wanted to share a quick thought for communion this morning, and something that's been running around my head a lot recently, and it's about the differences in culture from compared to today to 2,000 years ago. So obviously today we have a lot of material possessions and a lot of things in our life that we use on a daily basis, such as a social media platform like Instagram or Facebook, and even things as simple as our cars that get us to work in the morning. If you look back 2,000 years ago, they didn't have any of those things. They didn't have a social media platform to check and see what's going on around the world. They didn't have a car that they could just drive 30 minutes to go and see a friend. So if we look in the last few hours of Jesus's life, he had a lot of hate and a lot of anger thrown in his direction. Even as he was hanging on the cross, there were still people around him throwing insults and showing that hate to him. And he still found it inside of him to love those people. So Jesus is included in all that. He didn't have a social media platform. He didn't have a car. And he didn't have a lot of the things that we have today. And he just focused on the person that was in front of him and loved them. So I think this is something that we can incorporate into our own lives. I think that we are called to follow Jesus. And that means picking up our cross every morning and dying to ourselves and following him. And so that includes focusing on the person who's in front of us and loving them. So I'm going to share real quick a prayer for the bread, and then I'm going to say a prayer for the cup. So will you pray with me? Dear God, we come to you this morning, and we are just so humbled by just the amount of love that you have for us, God. The fact that you would send your only son down to this earth to shed his blood for our sins, it shows how much you care for us, God. So we want to thank you for that. God, I pray that whenever we wake up in the mornings, God, that we can pick up our cross, God, and that we can follow Jesus' example as best as we can. So God, I thank you for the body and for the sacrifice that was made for us, God. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. So now I'm going to say prayer for the cup. Will you pray with me again? Dear God, we come to you again, and I just thank you for the blood of Jesus, God. I thank you for the meaning behind it, God. I pray that you will send your Holy Spirit down this morning, God, and just insert your Spirit into our hearts, Lord. I pray that we can continue on the rest of this week and just to the best of our ability, live for you, God. I pray that as we continue into the work week, God, I pray that we can continue to focus on the people who are in front of us in the moment, God, and love them. Because that is what you have called us to do, God. You have called us to love other people the way Jesus did. So once again, God, I thank you for the sacrifice that Jesus made for us. And I pray that we can remember that on a daily basis, God. So I thank you for the blood of Jesus Christ. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. Have a good Sunday.
Lord, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest, and without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you. Where sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Where you are, Lord, I am free. Christ in me, Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. So teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, and when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. And when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you.
You're my
one. My righteousness, oh God, how I need you.
Masks, they protect us, but they also do something else. They can hide our identity. And so, in these very challenging times, when we need people, and when we need God, we may put on the metaphorical mask to hide our need. But God wants you to be authentic before Him and know that your truest self is in the presence of the cross, is with Jesus. No matter how much you try and hide from God, He sees you and loves you behind the mask.
Hey, thanks for watching and worshiping with us, and happy 4th of July weekend. I just want to let you know that my wife and I are proud Americans. My wife, if you didn't know this, is a naturalized citizen, and so she has been an American for a few years now, and close to 15 years now. So we are just proud of that. Hey, this morning, I'm going to share with you two stories. And I want to begin with one of those stories is Jesus healing a deaf and mute man in Mark chapter 7. And then another story of Jesus healing a blind man in Mark chapter 8. If it's your first time here, we're going to read God's word together. If you could stand with me, if you're willing and able to stand, please do so at the reading of God's word. I will be reading aloud what's in white. If you could please read aloud what's in yellow. This is the Word of God for the people of God, beginning in Mark chapter 7, verses 31 through 35. Then Jesus left the vicinity of Tyre and went to Sidon, down to the Sea of Galilee and into the region of the Decapolis. That means 10 cities. And there were some people brought to him. There are some people brought to him a man who was deaf and could hardly talk. And they begged Jesus to place his hand on him. And after he took him aside, away from the crowd, Jesus put his fingers into the man's ears, and then he spit and touched the man's tongue. So no physical distancing here for Jesus. And then he looked up to heaven and with a deep sigh said to him, Ephphatha, which means be opened. At this, the man's ears were opened, his tongue was loosened, and he began to speak plainly. Now, Mark chapter 8, verses 22 through 25. Jesus came to Bethsaida, and some people brought a blind man and begged Jesus to touch him. He took the blind man by the hand and led him outside the village. When he had spit on the man's eyes and put his hands on him, Jesus asked, "Do you see anything?" He looked up and said, "I see people. They look like trees walking around." Once more, Jesus put his hands on the man's eyes. Then his eyes were opened, his sight was restored, and he saw everything clearly. This is a reading from God's Word to you out of the Gospel of according to Mark. If you believe God's Word, say, I believe God's Word in the comments right now. Say, amen, all right? Thanks so much for helping me read God's Word today. So Jesus heals a deaf and mute man and then a blind man with spit. He also does this in John chapter 9 where he spits in the dirt and makes mud and puts it on the man's eyes. So you could say, in some sense, Jesus anoints them with holy saliva. If we were to rewrite some songs, maybe we could sing a parody called, there is power, power, wonder-working power in the spit of the Lamb. Okay, but seriously, all right? Some believe that in Jesus' day, many people believed in the healing power of saliva. And Jesus may have been doing all this spitting to help the people whom he was about to heal give them a little bit of faith. I think it was out of kindness to them, out of kindness to increase their faith in anticipation that something miraculous was about to happen. Jesus may have been helping them believe that they were about to receive a healing. Jesus used a common belief that was in the cultures of that day as an act of kindness for the subject and the audience. Except this time, it worked because Jesus is a true healer. I was recently reminded that lightning can strike the same place twice, and in fact, it does so repeatedly. So Jesus, unlike lightning, doesn't seem to heal the same way twice. Even though we see three healings using spit, it was all done differently. So if you're looking at somebody else's healing as a template for your healing, then Jesus may have something very special in store for you. Just wait and hold on. Jesus is going to do something unique for you if you'll have faith in him today. So you might be thinking, what about everybody else who's getting good stuff? Everybody else who's getting good gifts? Everybody else who's receiving a healing? Well, Jesus, like he took both men away from the crowd and one of them outside of his village, even though I believe the disciples were probably present to witness the healing so Jesus could teach them something. Listen to this. Just as he took those men outside the crowd, outside the village, and he focused on them specifically, I believe he focuses on you as well. Hear me out. The prophet Moses visited with God in the tent of meeting in the book of Exodus, outside the camp, which many interpret as God being in the margins of the people on this earth. So Jesus takes you outside the crowd because this is a space where he works well. Would you receive his attention today? Would you allow him to take you by the hand outside of the crowd, outside of the village, outside of your neighborhood? So he can do something on the outside that you want done so badly in your life right now. If you're on the outside looking in, this is where Jesus arrives and does his best work on the inside. See, the Gentiles were on the outside looking in. I want you to take notice of some things that Mark does here in his gospel. I want you to notice that Mark positions these two stories as bookends around the feeding of the 4,000 in Mark chapter 8. This is Jesus's second miraculous feeding. That's right. He does this twice. He feeds thousands of people. The first feeding was of the 5,000, and that was to a primarily Jewish crowd. And the second feeding was in a Gentile populated territory, so it's to a primarily Gentile audience. The first miracle to the deaf and mute man was healed. This guy was healed in Gentile territory and was likely a Gentile himself. And the blind man was healed in Bethsaida and was likely Jewish. And Bethsaida is this fishing village, which was likely the same location of the first feeding, the feeding of the 5,000. And notice during this healing that the man became partially healed and then completely healed. Did you see that? He became partially healed and then completely healed. Now, Jesus could heal somebody completely the first go, but Jesus takes the opportunity to do it twice. Some believe that this is because many of the Jews had a stubborn unbelief. This illustrates that even with the most stubborn cases of unbelief and spiritual blindness, Jesus can give that person clarity of sight. Speak plainly. Yeah, I want you to speak plainly and say, I was blind, but now I see. See, someone may be watching right now, operating under like 50% spiritual sight because you see what appear to be trees walking around, but you should be seeing people. So speak plainly. Give that testimony. I was blind, but now I see. And then Jesus wants you to see clearly. Ask Jesus for a full restoration of your sight, to see God and His beloved creation made in His image so that you can love God and love your neighbor. Speak plainly and see clearly to love God and to love your neighbor. Here's a spiritual truth. Jesus can give sight to the most stubborn spiritual blindness. Jesus can give life to the hardest of hearts. Jesus once said this, "Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God." After both feedings, there were basketfuls of food left over. And this is telling us that Jesus provides abundantly to all people, both Jews and Gentiles. And after the second feeding of the Gentiles, Jesus warns his disciples to watch out for the yeast of the Pharisees and of Herod. And he's talking about Herod Antipas, the tetrarch he's known as. And the Pharisees and the religious leaders and Herod do something that they've never done before. They conspire together to do what? To execute Jesus. So Jesus warns His disciples about their yeast, because their yeast was the sin of unbelief. And their yeast was the sin of unbelief that grew so toxic in their hearts and their minds that it led them to murder the innocent, nonviolent Jesus. The disciples, though, didn't get what he was saying when he said, "Beware the yeast of the Pharisees and Herod." They thought that he was referring to literal bread. And so in Mark chapter 8, verses 14 through 21, Mark says that the disciples got into a boat with Jesus to cross the Sea of Galilee. And Mark makes clear to mention that the disciples did not bring any of the leftover food from the mass feeding except one loaf of bread. So Mark is teaching us something. He's alluding because he's looking back in hindsight and he's understanding everything that Jesus was trying to teach them, right? Mark was alluding to Jesus being the one bread. Mark was alluding that he was the one loaf, that they didn't understand Jesus' comments to them in the moment about yeast. I mean, they're like, what, is Jesus talking about bread? To which Jesus says, why are you guys talking to each other about bread? Why are you talking about having no bread? Do you still not see or understand? Are your hearts hardened? Do you have eyes but fail to see and ears but fail to hear? And don't you remember? This is in Mark's Gospel, chapter 8, verses 17 through 18. And he asks them about the many basketfuls of bread that were left over from the first and second feeding. And they answer correctly by saying that there was 12 and 7 left over. And so Jesus says, do you still not understand? But what were they to understand when Jesus says, do you still not understand? I believe the Apostle John helps us understand what they did not understand in his gospel after Jesus fed the 5,000. This is how the Apostle John recounts the story. He adds to it with this. Jesus says to them after feeding the 5,000, he says, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry. And whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. But as I told you, you have seen me and still you do not believe. This is what Jesus was referring to when he says, do you still not understand? Listen, you cannot remain a person who still doesn't understand. That in talking about being behind the mask, you're a person who has the ability to understand. You're the person who may have ignorance in your life, but you have the ability to understand better. You cannot continue to wear a mask of ignorance, to wear a mask of saying, I don't understand or I don't have to understand. You cannot continue to remain ignorant about Jesus, the bread of life. You can't. It's important to know who Jesus is and who Jesus came to save. You are to speak plainly and see clearly. In Acts chapter 17, the Apostle Paul quotes the men of Athens in the meeting of the Areopagus. And if you don't know what that is, that's the high court in Athens, Greece. The Areopagus literally meant the Rock of Ares in the city of Athens. It was the center of the temples, of cultural facilities, and the high court. And so the Apostle Paul quotes from Cretan, the philosopher, the Cretan philosopher Epimenides, and from the Cilician Stoic philosopher Aratus. As he's surrounded by statues of pagan gods and idols. And so in Acts chapter 17, verses 29 through 31, Paul is teaching them, and he says to them, therefore, since we are God's offspring, he's telling them that all of them have been created by God. He says, we should not think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone, an image made by human design and skill. In the past, God overlooked such ignorance. But now, he commands all people everywhere to repent. For he has set a day when he will judge the world with justice by the man, Jesus, he has appointed. He has given proof of this to everyone by raising Jesus from the dead. So Paul's talking to them about all the idols that surround them. He saw one that said to an unknown God, and he said, let me tell you about this unknown God whom you worship. I got to ask you this question. What are the idols that surround you? What might be some of your unknown gods that you are worshiping in the place of the living God? What are some of the idols that surround you and your family? See, the resurrection, I want to tell you, the resurrection of Jesus demolishes all those idols. And then Jesus reconstitutes them, changing their form into the living God. How might Paul today speak truth to those idols using the philosophers of our day? Listen, Jesus is wanting to help us to understand that ignorance, that false worship, that false idols is no longer an excuse. That ignorance is not an excuse for sin. That ignorance is not an excuse. Willful ignorance is not one either. The good news, though, is that ignorance can be corrected with intentionality, like that of the inquisitiveness of the Athenians. Hey, listen. Some sneered at what Paul said, but others desired to learn more. I was at a dinner party where the host and his friend were belittling Colin Kaepernick as a person due to his peaceful protest. I spoke up and said, "Can I offer a different perspective?" And the host said that he did not understand the protest and that the average American could not either. And I appealed to him by saying that, well, you're not the average American, and that he could spend a moment or some time watching videos or reading articles, watching documentaries or reading a book, perhaps, to understand racial injustice and police brutality against unarmed black men and women in this country. And he said to me that he did not have time for it. Now, I tell you this story to use it as an illustration to teach a principle to all of us, that in regards to dealing with any subject, even ones that we initially disagree or dismiss or find uncomfortable, that we can dedicate the time to listen to different perspectives. And if we need to change course, we are free under the Spirit of God to do so. Because where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom to have a change of heart. All right, lean in. If you're a follower of Jesus, you know that within your journey, you might have been like the Berean church that Luke describes in Acts chapter 17 as being more noble character than those in Thessalonica. That when Paul and Silas preached to them, the Word of God says in Acts 17, beginning in verse 11, that they received the message with great eagerness and examined the Scriptures every day to see if what Paul said was true about the resurrection of Jesus. And as a result, many of them believed, as did also a number of prominent Greek women and many Greek men. And many are doing likewise right now as I preach, because we are seeking to understand Jesus more. That we're seeking not only knowledge, but we seek the wisdom of God so that we can be like what Jesus said to do in His Sermon on the Mount. Put His words into action, which is what a wise man or woman does when we hear the Word of God preached, or when we read the Word of God, we will do what God's Word says. Maya Angelou says this, "Do the best you can until you know better. Then when you know better, do better." See, God is doing a good work in you. Keep moving forward. Take time to listen to God. Read His Word and reflect on it. Meditate it. Put it on your heart and in your mind. And then pray to the Father in heaven, because He cares for you and He wants to hear from you and He wants to speak to you. Take time to examine the work of Jesus, not only in His Word, but I want you to listen to the testimonies of His witnesses, because they've experienced Jesus and they've got hope to share. You can no longer claim ignorance. Jesus can give sight to the most stubborn spiritual blindness, and Jesus can give life to the hardest of hearts. If you've been praying for somebody to know Jesus, keep praying. If you've been sharing with someone to know Jesus, keep sharing, because it might be a long path of obedience, a long path of prayer, and a long path of sharing, and a long path of witnessing, and a long path of being an example. A long, arduous, troublesome path that requires patience and faith and hope for the journey. Listen, God wants you to be set free, and He wants your loved ones to be set free. God has given you the freedom and agency to believe in His Son Jesus, to repent and to love Him with all your heart. Jesus once quoted the prophet Isaiah in Matthew chapter 13, verses 14 through 16. He said this to the people. He said, "You will be ever hearing, but never understanding. You will be ever seeing, but never perceiving. For His people's heart has become calloused. They hardly hear with their ears, and they have closed their eyes. Otherwise, they might see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their hearts and turn, and I would heal them." This is for you. "But blessed are your eyes because they see, and your ears because they hear." May you be blessed with eyes to see and ears to hear and hearts to beat the love of Jesus. That's my prayer for you, each and every one of you that's watching right now. Listen, I want you, if you need Jesus, to let us know in the comments. I want you to give your praises so that we can celebrate with you, and offer your prayer so that we can pray for you. We are a praying church. We are a body of Christ that believes in Jesus. We are a body of Christ that seeks to see Him, to speak plainly, and to see clearly Jesus. We are that body here, and we seek to be people who are better today than we were yesterday, because the blood of Jesus that cleanses us, continually cleanses us, as we continue to put our faith and hope in Him and profess Him and confess Him daily. May you turn your hearts towards Jesus, no matter how long you've been stubborn, and if you've ever been willfully ignorant, and if you're a place where you answer the question, do you still not understand? You're like, "I don't," but Jesus is here seeking to help you. He takes you by the hand out of the crowd, out of the village, and He does His best work with you on the margins. If you're feeling on the outside, and you want to be in, Jesus calls you. Will you put your faith and trust in Him today? Amen. Let the church say amen.
That I face, stronger than the power of the grave, constant in the trial and the change. This one thing remains, this one thing remains. Your love never fails and never gives up and never runs out on me. Your love never fails and never gives up and never runs out on me. Your love never fails and never gives up and never runs out on me. Your love.
Thanks once again for watching and worshiping with us at Littleton Church Online. I want to tell you this, that I thank God for each and every one of you who's watching today, especially the Littleton Church. I recently saw you as a congregation wishing Nanette Roberts a very happy birthday. You were so loving and kind to one another. You were fulfilling the command to love one another. You can see this video on our YouTube page under special events, where you can see a drive-through happy birthday celebration for Nanette. It was really special. And I thank God for the Littleton Church, who has been given the Spirit of God. Each and every one of you has been given the Spirit of God. If you've proclaimed Jesus as Lord and been baptized in His name, and you've been doing so good here in this place, I want to commend you for the ways and you've been doing good, for engaging online, watching and worshiping with us, and the ways that you've been serving one another and your community. I just praise God for the ways in which you've been staying engaged, and also the ways that you've been a witness to the gospel in our county and the Tri-County area. And I believe that when you do good here, you are doing good for this country. That's right. You're doing good for this country. Your faithfulness is being noticed. All right, if you're a first-time guest here, I want to thank you so much for watching with us. And I want to tell you that if you would like to, you can give to the work of the church here in Centennial, Colorado, and abroad. I want to thank our members who have been giving faithfully for the past several months as we have been safe at home and sheltering in place. Thank you so much. What you're doing is helpful. There's three ways in which you can give. You can give online by going to littletonchurch.org, and in the right-hand corner of our page, you can click Give, and you can give safely and securely there. You can also see places right on our homepage to download our church app and give right from your phone. You can find it in your Google Play Store or in your Apple Store as well. Or you can also mail in your offerings. We accept those three forms of giving. Thank you so much for participating, and God is pleased in your faithful generosity. All right, I want to offer us a prayer and a blessing as we close. Holy Father, we ask you to help us speak plainly and to see clearly. Lord, may we not use ignorance as an excuse. May we remove that mask, Lord. And Lord, may we accept your wisdom. May we accept your wisdom unto salvation. May we cast aside any sin of unbelief, any yeast that is destructive. And Lord, may we choose to put our faith and hope and trust in Jesus Christ. We pray this not only for ourselves, but for our family, and for our neighbors, for this state, for this country. We pray, Lord, for an outpouring of grace and salvation. It's through Jesus Christ, Lord, we ask of these things. Amen. Let the church say amen again. All right. Go love God. Go love people. Go in peace. And we'll see you back here next week.